morning, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome to Just Plain Living. I'm John Gray.
Hi, I'm Peggy Burton.
And I'm Jim Fuller.
And I was just thinking, these pumpkins will be gone next week, won't they? It'll be December.
Yes, pumpkins will be gone.
It came in a hurry, didn't it?
Yes, it has.
It's
cold out there, too.
I know.
It is.
I know. Frost is definitely on the pumpkins.
Except in here.
Did y'all have a happy Thanksgiving?
Did. How about you?
It was a beautiful day.
It was.
It really was.
It was a,
good
day. Was a nice day, wasn't it? Yeah,
it was really pretty.
Sure was.
We had a couple of days like that last week. And people were out having fun.
Yes.
Stuffing themselves.
Which is typical of Tennessee because it'll change. As John said many times, and the weather will
shortly.
Change. Yeah.
Everybody woke up the next morning and were whining because they couldn't zip their pants. Lots of food. Too much food.
Lots of food. Good food.
We've talked about this many times, but it's just not fair because in the 3 or 4 days that usually encompasses Thanksgiving, you can gain 4 or 5 pounds.
I know, easily.
In just that short amount of time, but then it ends up taking you
And 3 or 4 weeks, and it's Christmas.
Yeah,
and there
to get
you go
rid
again.
Of it, yeah. So.
Discipline.
That is true. I mean, it's just like I've said this before. When I was working out a whole lot, and I'd get on a treadmill, and I'd stay on a treadmill for an hour at 6 miles an hour with the incline as high as it'd go, and I'd burn 1,400 calories, and that's sweat running all over you. That's one Snickers bar.
Yeah, that's right.
It just doesn't seem fair.
That's right.
That is absolutely true.
And then let's see, what else happened? It was Black Friday. A lot of deals and sales. Then Saturday was Shop Small Saturday, Shop Local, which is something that we try to promote.
And we should.
Bunch because, our small town businesses are, please try to go to something that's locally owned and operated first. Because all those tax dollars stay at home and all the profit stays at home. And, those are the people who support local things.
That's right. We need to
they're the ones
them.
You go to get a check for a wheelchair or your Little League uniforms and stuff like that. Those are the people who do that.
Right.
And it's hard to call Atlanta and get a check for a Gold Star mother to have an air conditioner in the summertime.
I would like to say that I'm a shopper. I do shop locally if I shop, but I am not a shopper. I have never been a shopper.
Well, you know,
some
I worked
people
in,
love to shop. I just
I
don't.
I worked in that business for a long time, clothing business, and I don't like to be waited on when I go somewhere. I'm not a shopper either.
Don't you hate
I walk
it when somebody...
in, I walk in and I look through stuff and I either see what I want or I don't. I see it.
Right.
I look at it. Can I afford it or not afford it? I either buy it or leave. Yeah, I don't need somebody
the
to
one
help
that,
me.
The one that I hate is when somebody says, that looks fabulous on you. And I know it just looks awful. I know I wouldn't buy it in a million years.
They say that to everybody.
I know.
Yeah.
Because they want to sell it. No.
Yeah. But we
have nice people here that are helpful in the shop.
Yes. But now I heard something, Jimmy, and you'll probably know more about this than I do. And I heard it just in passing that Amazon,
excuse me,
who so many people buy stuff online, and there's all these Amazon commercials and stuff, some of their employees went on strike during Black Friday or something like
that. I have not heard that.
But then I didn't hear anything else about it.
Yeah.
So if that would have happened, I think it'd have been big news.
Yeah.
So maybe I dreamed it.
You think they were
know.
Going on strike
well,
because
you, we,
they
we
were...
live in an era where you see things on the internet all
they're
the time.
Well, but this wasn't on the internet. But, I forget where this was.
No, they're definitely not necessarily true. But
a lot of fake news out there.
It's all
right.
There's a whole lot of that stuff.
Yeah.
And then, of course, yesterday was Cyber Monday.
Yeah.
So they've got all of these things, happening. And, of course, Black Friday started, I don't know, what has that been going on now, maybe 10 years, 15 years, something like that?
Yeah, at least, yeah.
Well, now Black Friday starts the Friday before Black Friday.
Yeah.
You know? And then it lasts two weeks after Black Friday.
It'll be your last chance. This is Wednesday. Yeah. Your last chance to buy from Black Friday.
Yeah. Right.
Yeah, so it's kind of funny.
It is. And you get, I get to Lou in my email, I get all kinds of advertisements.
Oh, I know. You just have to delete.
Yeah, no, you have six more hours to get free shipping.
Right.
20% off or whatever.
Although sometimes they really have good deals.
Oh,
but,
yeah.
But I remember one night I was working late at the office. It was about 9 o'clock, and I saw this shirt that I really wanted. And I started to buy it, and it was on sale for some ridiculously low price, like $28 or something like that. You know, which is pretty cheap.
Cheap for a shirt.
And I thought, well, I it's late. I'm going to go home. I'll buy it first thing in the morning. I came in the morning, pulled it up, and no, they had the shirt. But now it was $89.
There you go.
So you got to
pull the trigger.
Yeah,
it's
right.
There.
Right.
You know, and I get magazines from Paul Frederick and Charles Truett and these people. And I've always been one who liked browns and greens and ecru and yellows, ochre-colored stuff. And for about 4 years now, 3 or 4 years, that everything's either been blue
or black
or gray,
or
and there's not been even a yellow shirt.
Yeah.
And I saw one in Paul Frederick that was a plaid, nice looking plaid yellow shirt. And I thought, I'm going to get that. Well, I forgot about it. And the next time a book came out, it's gone.
Yeah.
It's not there anymore. And that, you know, you would think that might show them, well, maybe people want that.
Exactly. Somebody ought to open a local shop.
Yeah, we tried. We used to have that for years.
And then,
and I miss that to some degree. You can get great deals and all that online, and that's pretty much where I buy clothes from now online. But you know, when you bought a suit from Jimmy Phillips when he was in business, it was good looking. Yeah, because they made it fit well.
Oh yeah.
I mean, you know, they stood you up on this little riser thing,
and it didn't cost anything.
It didn't cost anything extra. It was included in
they
the suit.
They tailored it, and
yeah,
you,
they
you
made
walked
the
right.
You know, and they, you know, they'd tailor the jacket, fix the sleeves so they were where you wanted them, and that sort of thing.
But it's really not that easy to find a tailor anymore, is it?
It is not, and. I find, you know, they do a good job. There's two or three around here, but, you know, a lot of times you'll tell them, I want it this length, and they'll think, well, I'm going to make it just a little bit longer.
Because he doesn't know what he's doing.
Yeah, he doesn't know what he's doing. And besides that, you can't put it back after you take it
off. That's right, once it's gone.
A lot of times.
Well, and there's a difference. What they don't realize is they're either going to take an inseam or an outseam.
Right.
And they don't realize, I've got a pair of pants on right now that I bought, and used to, when you bought a pair of pants, the zipper was about that long in it. Now the zipper's about that long.
Yeah.
So the rise in the pants is shorter, so unless they have them on you, and
you
see
really
where you're going to wear
them. That's
right.
True.
Because they're different. You know, used to, if you bought a 36-inch waist pants, you could take a tape measure, and they measured 36. Now you buy one company's 36, and it's 34, and another one's, well, none of them are 38s because they're not going to spend that much material. So, you know, you have to pretty much try stuff on. That's why having a tailor, in-shop tailor, is an important thing.
Sure.
When I was very young, I went to Hong Kong, and that was the big shopping place of the world, and the tailor would come to your hotel room and measure you for whatever, and that afternoon you could wear it out.
Yeah.
Can you imagine getting all that done?
That's all they had to do.
And they measured your feet, delivered you shoes that evening.
Polished and ready to go.
It was amazing.
Sounds fun to me.
I don't know if they still do it, but they probably do.
We used to have a tailor that would come to the hotel when we were in Atlanta. Because I know one time a lot of us that were from Tullahoma had were big Tennessee fans.
Yeah.
And we got on this strange kick, and then we wanted orange blazers, double-breasted blazers.
That were going to be so fine.
And this dude comes out there, and he measures all of us, and we all bought it. It was at some ridiculous price. I remember sure. They were ridiculously high, you know.
And, but think how fine.
And an orange blazer is not something you can just wear anywhere, you know. You know, as you,
unless you're coaching at UT.
I probably actually wore it four or five times, yeah. but I mean, you can't even wear them to the ball game, really. If,
yeah,
you know,
it's not, just too cold.
Yeah.
No, it's clothing is a different deal, and you know, people dress differently now.
Well,
you don't see that many people in suits. Your bankers aren't in suits.
No.
I mean, we live in a casual world.
We live in a world where somebody ought to be able to put those little taps on the backs of your shoes. You know what I'm talking about?
Well, the shoe repairmen, they're hard to find.
We used to have one. Yeah. And now you have to go to Murfreesboro. I think there's
Nashville.
One in Shelbyville. But that's a crying shame.
Those people over in Shelbyville can't fix leather soles and stuff.
Oh, they can't?
No. I mean, I had my Florsheim shoes, I had to go to Nashville on Church Street to find a guy up there who could put new soles and heels on my leather shoes.
Wow. Because, you know, you spend $100-something for a pair of shoes that really work.
Oh, yeah.
You'd like to wear them another season.
Well, and the tops will last
forever.
Almost. If you take care of them.
Right.
So there's a job for someone. A good job.
No, it won't work because most of the shoes, even your high-dollar shoes, unless you're paying $200 or $300 for a pair of shoes, have rubber soles on them. When they wear out, you throw them away. We live in a throwaway society.
Yes.
It's too bad.
It is too bad.
Yeah.
I think it's too bad.
All right, before we leave.
Now that we have solved the world problem.
Here you go. Number 225. Life is filled with sacrifices, some given for good, some taken in vain. Significant are those given by turkeys, without which there would be no turkey sandwiches.
I knew we'd get to sandwiches before this place.
We'll be right back after these messages.
It's football time in Tennessee, and nobody tackles the competition like the Russell Barnett Automotive family. With 6 locations to serve you, certified collision center, over 1,000 new and pre-owned vehicles to choose from at RussellBarnett.com, hometown auto rental, limited lifetime powertrain warranty on certain units, certified pre-owned units, too many reasons to mention why. Keep asking the question, why buy anywhere else?
Ah, the glory days. Running to daylight on the gridiron and chasing a ball with a mind of its own. Cheering the team to victory and marching to the beat of your own drum. Memories that last a lifetime. But sometimes we're reminded of our glory days in ways we'd rather forget. Get back in the game. The rehab team at Life Care Center of Tullahoma is ready to help you live and play well.
Get your news first, fast, and free with your news leader on 6 every Tuesday, Thursday, and Saturday nights at 6, 8, and 10 p.m. Local weather, sports, community calendar events, and a comprehensive look at the latest news stories and newsmakers as only a video news broadcast can do. Get it first, fast, and free with news leader on Channel 6, your local information network.
Welcome back. Excuse me. I'm all choked up about my next guest. Because I'm so happy to have Chief Paul Blackwell here joining us on the set today for our segment we call Police Pointers. I was just kind of wondering, Paul, it's pretty cold out there today.
How cold is it?
That's not where I was going with that.
Well, you know, that's that. Okay, I'm sorry.
Actually,
it is a little chilly.
I'm trying to think of a response to that would be appropriate for television, but I can't think of it right at the moment. So you tell me how cold it is.
It's pretty chilly.
It's pretty chilly.
Yeah, I guess we could go back to many of the descriptions our parents had and everything. And,
right.
You know, yeah. Probably wouldn't be appropriate for TV.
The ones I'm thinking about are not.
No, the first thing came to my mind was probably not something my mom would like to hear me say on TV.
Yeah, right, right. So I'll skip over that. Do you require your police officers actually to make traffic stops on days like today when it's 20 degrees?
Yeah.
You do?
We the job keeps going. We have to work in all kinds of weather, and probably the most difficult time to do traffic stops in the rain, because obviously we know what happens when rain hits paper and you try to write with ink pen.
But
we still got to do the job, and I've oftentimes have used the analogy when I've stopped somebody in bad weather that if I'm getting out into the weather to talk to you about this, you should understand it's pretty.
Yeah,
right. This is not just a I'm wanting to mess with you thing.
Right.
It's pretty serious,
Yeah, right.
If I'm almost standing, the rain is pouring down on me and everything else while I'm trying to talk to you, then you, the driver, should understand, maybe I did mess up. This is not just one of those things where someone wants to say, why don't you go, that old saying you always hear, why don't you go out and arrest the murderers, the rapists, and the robbers, and it's like.
Have you ever had anybody tell you that?
Oh, yeah. I think anyone's been in law enforcement any amount of time has had someone say that.
Yeah.
And, of course, my response is, well, if we had that happening, that's what we'd be doing.
Right.
But, people that run stop signs seem to occur much more frequently than a murder, a robbery, a rape, a hump, something of that nature.
So, right.
People say it, they don't really understand maybe what they're saying when they say it. So,
I know this is not what we're talking about, our subject was, but do you find, or do your officers find, are more people cordial than not cordial when you, or most?
People are more willing to argue with the officers in the street than what I've experienced in my years. And there used to always be a saying that, it was pretty widespread that the place to argue with an officer is in the courtroom, not on the street, because on the street, the officer is going to be the one that wins.
Right.
But now it is. It's not uncommon for someone to just start challenging you the minute you come in contact with them. And, I think there's some contributors to that. I mean, the media and uh-huh. the availability of showing confrontations like that.
Right.
So it is unfortunate because the officers, they're not necessarily looking for a confrontation or an adversarial encounter. They're looking to do their job. And, you like to tell most people that, you treat someone decently, you're going to get treated decently.
Right.
And so, yes, I've seen a change. And it's somewhat disheartening because a lot of times when we're called to something, we've been called because somebody has a need for the police.
Right.
And, we're there because someone has called us. Mm-hmm. Or we're stopping somebody on the road that is running a stop sign or a red light. Mm-hmm. You committed a violation and, it just happened to be the police officer was around that time. How many times have you gotten away with it and not been caught? So. It's kind of disheartening.
You were talking a moment ago about the fact that sometimes people say things like, well, why aren't you getting the rapists and the murderers? But I'm sure you encounter situations where you may see someone committing maybe a traffic violation, mm-hmm. but there's more serious issues, and you have to pick and choose.
Yeah. And we do. There are times where when you may be talking to somebody and a call of more importance comes out, and it just became that person's lucky day because you got to say, I've got to go, but mind your speed, stop at the stop signs, do whatever you need to do to move on.
Right.
But on the flip side of that is we tell officers that don't disregard, say, the tail light out or the brake light out, because so many good things have come from traffic stops,
right?
Warrants, finding people that are wanted, and you would not have found that otherwise had you not paid attention to that that little violation.
I hadn't thought about that, but
so we tell people, don't think, oh well, it's just a tail light. Right. That tail light could lead to something else.
Right.
You know, and look, one of the biggest things we encounter in our traffic stops are people that don't have driver's license. Suspended, revoked. I mean, over and over. And we would never find that if we didn't, you know, pay attention to even the smallest thing like a tail light out.
Right.
And how many do we find that don't have insurance?
Right.
You know, if you're involved in an accident, the first thing you want to know is, do they have insurance? And we find a whole lot of people that are driving that do not have insurance, and we find it by making a traffic stop. So there's a lot of value to encouraging our officers to make traffic stops. It doesn't mean every traffic stop has to result in a ticket. It can result in a warning or a, you know, something, a verbal warning that says, be mindful of it. You know, something of that nature.
Right.
Just because you stop someone does not mean you're getting a ticket.
Right.
But, you know, if a citation is necessary, then the officers have that discretion to issue it.
Right.
But a lot of good things come out of traffic stops.
The last time I got stopped, it was because, not that long ago, and it was because my tag had expired.
Sure.
And it was actually about March, and my tag had expired in November of the previous year.
So that happened quite a bit.
So when it was pointed out to me, I remembered where that tag was, where that sticker
that renewal was.
It was.
You know, you get it usually 6 weeks before it expires, so it's easy to set it somewhere out of sight, out of mind,
right.
You know, unless you're going to handle it right away. And we get that a lot of times. And so a lot of times the officer, you know, just uses that as an opportunity to remind someone if it's not too far out of date. But then we also have adopted a philosophy or a culture on certain violations. Let's say a registration.
Mm-hmm.
Yours, the example you use, maybe 6 months expired. I encourage officers to write the ticket.
Mm-hmm.
And then that says to you, hey, I better go take care of this. So when you show up to court, you can then show the judge, I took care of this,
right.
And let the judge dismiss it. You know, if you don't put some requirement on somebody and he just says, hey, you need to get it done, you may say, sure, I'll get it.
You know, I was lucky in my case because I actually had the sticker, that I'd actually had the renewal and forgot to
put it on. Just hadn't put it on the car.
Yeah, and I was within 100 yards of my office where the sticker was laying on my desk. I told the officer I'd be happy to show it to him, put it on in his presence. He actually said,
which something like that, we can check the computer and the computer's going to tell us that you have renewed it.
Yeah.
You know, so it's that explanation would be valuable.
Yeah.
You know, would be a true statement. Now, I can tell you an example here in Tullahoma that an elderly person got stopped for not having one of the brake lights wasn't working. The officer wrote him a ticket, and boy, my phone was burning up from family members. Why'd you do this? It's just a simple little brake light happened. So I went through the explanation but by writing the citation to this person, it made it necessary for them to take care of it quickly.
Right.
And then when they went to court, it happened just like I said, the judge dismissed it, but you know, we want the safety issue to be taken care of now, not, okay, I'll take care of it, and another month has passed, another whatever, you know. We're going to write you the ticket. You go get it fixed. You show up in court, and it's dismissed.
Right.
And I think, you know, from my standpoint, I'm satisfied with that process because it's forcing people to get that safety issue corrected.
And they're actually very important safety issues.
Yeah, I mean, it's not just them, it's other people.
Right.
I mean, how many times have you pulled up behind a car and they have no brake lights?
Right.
And what do you say? Don't tell them what you say. You know, blah, 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 you know, or someone that, you know, doesn't have their headlights on at night and then you come to find out the headlights are burned out. You know, I mean,
you actually encounter that time.
I mean, there's all types, and some people just, I'm not sure about cars nowadays, but there used to be that if your brake lights were out and your dash lights were out, it meant you had a fuse blown.
Yes.
You know, and a lot of people didn't know that. So it's like, check this simple thing first.
Yeah.
And you know, of course, the old days, you take the gum wrapper and wrap it around the fuse, stick it back in there, and it
works. Might burn your car up.
Might burn your car up, but, you know.
Yeah, they'll be working for a while.
You know, little things like that that we bring it to someone's attention. And again, take the brake lights, unless you back up to a plate glass window and see whether your brake lights are working. You don't know if they're working or not.
So, that's right.
No telling how long someone may have been driving around with no brake lights.
Yeah.
So that we kind of tried to change the culture and let officers understand that philosophy and use that as the explanation that, look, this is for your safety. You fix this, the judge is going to dismiss it.
Oh, yeah.
And, you know, and everybody's good.
Right. Yeah. You know, I've got an older vehicle that I used to haul stuff around and stuff, and I don't drive it every day.
Mm-hmm.
And when I do drive it, it might have been 2 months since I've driven it, but I'll actually walk around that vehicle and make sure all the lights and stuff are working, because it's not something you would.
And people will tell us, this is just my junk vehicle that I, but you still got, if you're going to be on the road, you still have to meet the standards of the road. And, you know, so we just have to educate our officers how to express that to the people,
right,
and let them know that, you know, this is a simple fix.
Yes.
But I'm giving you this piece of paper so you remember I got to fix this.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Well, it appears that we have talked through the
whole. Are we out of time already?
We've talked through the whole segment. We'll get to the handicap parking.
I'll be back
next time.
In 2 weeks, we'll be back. And maybe next time you'll let me do the introductions.
I will.
Maybe I'll do the introduction.
I would be happy to.
We'll change that up.
We'll change that up.
So everybody should be looking forward to our next.
Actually, we'll even let you sit in this chair since this is usually the
commentator.
Yeah.
The man in charge.
Yeah. But we'd be happy to have a police officer sitting in this chair, because I don't think we ever had one up here.
Well, we can do it.
Okay.
We'll do it.
All right. Paul, thank you so much.
All right.
It's always a pleasure to see you.
All right, thank you.
Folks, we'll be right back in a moment with more Living right after this.
Let me tell you about the toughest guy on earth. He does the work of two jobs, but only gets paid for one.
He's tough enough to feed the man, gave him a lifetime of nourishment.
He has the crazy strength to lift the man that raised him up without even flinching.
That's right. No employee of the month bonus check here.
This guy, no, this warrior, will always be by his father's side, even if his dad will hardly remember. Good luck finding a gym to train for that. If this guy isn't the toughest guy on the planet, then I don't know who is. Caregiving is tougher than tough. Find the care guides you need at aarp.org/caregiving.
Is this the year you want to get fit? If so, check out just some of the things Tullahoma Parks and Rec has to offer. Kickboxing, aerobics, silver sneakers workouts, swim lessons, boot camp, water aerobics, basketball, Zumba, yoga, pickleball, lap swimming, treadmill, karate. Get fit, Tullahoma, and have some fun with Tullahoma Parks and Rec.
When your family suffers the loss of a loved one, the caring and compassionate staff at Tullahoma Funeral Home and Coffee County Funeral Chapel are standing by to assist you in every way possible. We are proud to support local industry and offer only Batesville caskets. Many funeral homes don't own or operate a crematory. We utilize the only crematory in Coffee County. Your loved one never leaves Coffee County. We can accommodate any need and any budget. Consider our complete pre-need service to remove this burden from your family during their time of grief. Lock in today's low costs and protect from inflation. Tullahoma Funeral Home and Coffee County Funeral Chapel. Our family caring for your family.
History about this and that. It's Conversations with John and Pat. With John and Pat. With John and Pat.
Hello, everyone. I'm John Rickman.
And this is Pat Welch. And John, we are here today for segment 83 The Conversations of John and Pat.
Marching to 100, Pat.
Marching to 100. It's going to be a great event.
The Wilburn brothers were somebody that I listened to when I was young. They were in the 50s, 60s, this sort of thing. My brother and I knew some of their songs, and this is one that I'd like to bring up.
Kind of dream that y'all might be on the...
We live 40 miles south of Nashville. We always thought 31A might lead us right straight to the capital of country music.
Wow.
And it did. It did lead us there. Mm-hmm. You know, we couldn't stick.
But you made it.
Yeah. We made it a little bit.
I like that story, John, that y'all got on the Grand Ole Opry. We got to take any pictures, but you felt like you'd be going back. Unfortunately, we didn't get a chance to go back.
We thought, and that was August 22nd, 1980. I know it just as well as my marriage date, my birthday.
But not quite as. But, embedded in your memory as the
But
marriage.
We went, we played, we did good. You know, they applauded for a total of 16 seconds. 16 seconds is a lot. 1001, 1002, they kept. I mean, they saw that we.
I don't know if the clapping at the conclusion of our show has been that long.
But this is the Wilburn Brothers song.
Play it on.
Roll, Muddy River, roll on, Muddy River, roll on. I've got a notion you'll go to the ocean alone. I've got a baby in Tennessee who's long been a-waiting for a little old me. So roll, Muddy River, roll on, Muddy River, roll on. New Orleans into old St. Louis, Stockton, Memphis, Minneapolis too. Back in Nashville, I'll be through. So roll, Muddy River, roll on. I love you, but just call it fate. You and I are gonna separate. You'll be here, but she won't wait. So roll, Muddy River, roll on. Roll, Muddy River, roll on. Roll, Muddy River, roll on, Muddy River, roll on. I've got a notion you'll go to the ocean alone. Well, I've got a baby in Tennessee who's long been a-waiting for a little old me. So roll, Muddy River, roll on, Muddy River, roll on, roll on.
Good, John.
And Wilburn Brothers. Teddy Wilburn and Doyle. Brothers. Teddy and Doyle. You know, when they died, like a lot of music industry folks have passed away in the last few years, old singers, it's like somebody in the family died.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Idols. Almost, yeah.
Well, I don't know if there were so much idols as there were just people that we sort of recognized and knew on television. Mm-hmm. You know, we recognized their voices.
Emulated and desired to be like.
To tell you the truth, I don't know any of the voices out there today that's sad, but I don't. Everything is... I listen to talk radio a lot and to lots of other things.
At one point, we used the song as a segue, and sometimes we had to stretch. And today, I did see a stretch from your words, the reminders up here, about a muddy river in Memphis.
Yeah.
So remember that part of the song, and I'm gonna bring that back into my.
Yeah.
And you'll be amazed. We have had several historical parts on the Civil War, John, before. And we've always made a real good disclaimer that we were not going to take sides and decide which cause was correct and so on and so forth. But we were going to recognize the valor and the sacrifice that both sides went through in the Civil War. And you've got a member of your family that had a horrific injury during the Civil War fighting for the South. And but today we're going to counteract that subsequent stories. We're going to talk about a story from the Union side. And I have mentioned several times that in my travels for my wholesale lumber company that I represent, there's a church between Seymour and Maryville in a very rural area. And that area, I believe, was the whole area is called Eusebia, and there's a Presbyterian church there that was started in the 1700s, and that, I believe,
that's a pretty church,
it's
man.
A beautiful church. And there's there can't be 300 people living in that community now, but the church has been such a focal point of that area that there's over 1,000 people buried there. Show that, see if we can see that, Philip, that picture number two. That's mm-hmm. That's just a small part of it, and if you look in the back, kind of the right side, you can see some mountains. Those are the Smokies, and if you come from the entrance of that church out, and it's facing the graveyards in the front of the church. It's a spectacular view of the Smokies.
You know, a lot of communities like that, Pat, were thriving communities back in the day.
Oh yeah, I'm sure they were
back
at some
in the
point.
Day.
The it doesn't matter how small the community is, if it's existed for long enough, you're gonna have plenty of people passing away.
Mm-hmm.
And I'd say a third to, at some points, maybe even 40% of the stones are, they'll never be able to read them. They're weathered, it's absolutely slick. But I'd say about every 4 or 5 times I go through there, which is every other week, I'll have enough time to just pull over around that church and go in the graveyard, and I almost always find something that's really interesting, and a lot of it's Civil War. And I found a member of the 3rd Tennessee Cavalry, which was Union Cavalry, and that section of the state was very loyal to the Union, and Andrew Johnson, who became president following Lincoln, he was the Union side governor equivalent of Tennessee, though of course he'd just been to the representing basically people in Upper East Tennessee. But anyway, this past time I came through, I got into section. I say there's over 1,000 graves there. I got into section in the graveyard. There was a tremendous amount of Pickens, P-I-C-K-E-N-S, was the name of the family. And once I started looking some of them up, it got to really picking my interest. There was a whole lot of the Pickenses, and I'll get into in a minute, that again served in the 3rd East Tennessee Cavalry Regiment. And one of the field officers, the highest ranking, was Colonel William C. Pickens, and found his stone. And Philip, let's go to picture number 4. William C. Pickens is that stone. He was born in 1825 and passed away in 1872, and was the field commander for this cavalry regiment, which was fairly large. His father was Samuel Pickens, and that is picture number 3, Philip. There we go. He was judge of Sevier County, which I think this section that's in Blount County, where this church is now, was at that time part of Sevier County.
Pat, did you do something to that stone to make those words?
Somebody else did. He lived from 1799 to 1862, died during the middle of the war. He had another son, Samuel Wiley Pickens, who was a major and also served under his, of course he served under his brother and served in that same cavalry regiment. And his picture, Philip, is number 5. And there's his in his Union uniform. He lived from 1830 to 1906. And they were originally mustered out of, I believe, Murfreesboro. Let me see. Well, we want to make sure we're telling where we're supposed to be. And soon after that, they picked up the company of the first part of that cavalry was from Upper East Tennessee was Company A. By the time they were mustered in Murfreesboro, they were added B, C, D, and E. So the regiment's growing big time. And they spent most of their action was in West Tennessee and then down into Mississippi. They came back to the Murfreesboro area after the Battle of Stones River, when the Union, of course, had Bragg retreat out of that. And they, at some point towards the end of the war, that regiment got into lower or to lower middle Tennessee and then into northern Alabama. And they got cornered by Nathan Bedford Forrest's Confederate cavalry. And on September 24th of 1864, men under Samuel Wiley, whose grave we showed, that was a younger brother of the colonel, the Major S.W. Pickens, he and 150 of his men were captured around Athens. And just above Athens the next day is was a really small area called Sulphur Trestle. And at that time, they Forrest captured another 400 of them on September the 25th. And as the war went on, and a lot of exchange, as it was obvious the South was going to be defeated, the officers were exchanged, so they gained their freedom December 15th. So I know Samuel W. was captured. I'm not sure about his brother, William C. The rest of those men that were in that company, and almost all the ones from Upper East Tennessee, then were going to be released. And they were taken out of a prisoner of war camp and put on a boat in Memphis, which then brings me into the segue of the song. And this was in the spring, I believe, in April of 1865. And the Mississippi, of course, was from the spring and floodwaters and so forth, was flowing really fast south. The boat is having to go north, and somehow, I don't know who is to blame, but the name of the boat was the Sultana, and it was over double occupancy rate that it was supposed to be in.
Because they were getting so much money for every passenger.
I would hate to bring that human frailty up, but you're probably right, John. But they weren't far out of Memphis, and one of the boilers exploded, and a whole lot of those men were killed. Mm-hmm. It's over 1,000, and I believe it was something like 175 of the Union cavalry members from Upper East Tennessee were killed. In fact, I could not find the stone, but I did find some records that one of Pickens, another relative of these two officers, that was not able, he was not exchanged with the other officers. He lost his life in that explosion. And then for a little bit of a side note, there was a not related closely, not another brother or a son of these two officers, is a Dr. Thomas H. Pickens, who was buried in that cemetery in that same area where all these Pickenses are buried in Eusebia. And he lived from 1864 to 1897. And he was 32 when he died, and I found a mention on findagrave.com that this Dr. Pickens was killed and shot by Dr. McPherson. And that's the only note I could find about his death. And I have spent several hours of time, and maybe I'm a little bit too fixated on it, trying to find out what happened there.
But it looks like they broke the Hippocratic Oath.
There was some kind of problem there, because the Dr. McPherson was never was not tried. I've researched and researched and researched, and you can't find anything other than Dr. Pickens was killed by Dr. McPherson when he was only 32 years old. And we'll leave our listeners and viewers to their imagination what in the world could happen where a man wasn't tried for a man for murder.
That was interesting, Pat. Yeah. East Tennessee. The Union Army. Right. And we're going to talk about the Southern Army here before long.
We're going to pick up the Southern Army, and we're going to talk about John's, the valor of one of his relatives. And I'm eagerly anticipating that. And this was closed out segment.
83.
We're not done. Management is desiring us to get to at least 100, and we can hardly wait. Thank you all.
It's Conversations with John and Pat, with John and Pat, with John and Pat.
It's time for every family and business in Tullahoma to go green and recycle. Telehoma Public Works makes it simple and easy to recycle. Just place your recyclable materials, paper, plastic, aluminum, and cardboard beside your garbage container on the same day your garbage is picked up. Your recycled materials don't have to be in a fancy container. Recycling is not only the right thing to do, it makes sense. Recycling pays. Paying to bury our garbage costs each of us. Please do your part. Let's go green, Tullahoma, and recycle.
Hi, I'm Cindy.
And I'm Jacob.
I'm the Rooster.
And I'm the Red Mate. And we would like to welcome you to
Roosterwear.
Yes, Roosterwear is a cottage industry producing accessories for men, women, children, babies, and pets. All items are hand-cut and sewn locally. Roosterwear specializes in bow ties, pocket squares, scarves, cufflinks, neckties, and aprons of all sizes for all ages. Baby products include onesies, diaper covers, bibs, and burp pads. All bow ties, tie-it-yourself, or pre-tied come with an adjustable neckband. All products can be made with a material of your choice, as special orders are available upon request. Don't be standing back looking at fashion. Create your own with Roosterwear.
Come visit us at
roosterandredmaiden.com
to find our handcrafted designs for
the cock of the walk.
I want to eat apples and bananas. I need to eat apples and bananas. Why can't I eat apples and bananas?
Support the Feeding America nationwide network of food banks to help provide meals to those in need. Join us at feedingamerica.org.
Get your news first, fast, and free with your news leader on 6 every Tuesday, Thursday, and Saturday nights at 6, 8, and 10 p.m. Local weather, sports, community calendar events, and a comprehensive look at the latest news stories and newsmakers as only a video news broadcast can do. Get it first, fast, and free with News Leader on Channel 6, your local information network.
Welcome back. South Jackson Civic Association every other year is proud to present the Nutcracker Fantasy, which is produced by Long School of Dance right here in Tullahoma. However, she has dancers that come from all about. And this opens a week from Friday in the daytime. We do educational outreach during Friday's daytime, and that night's a parade, and Saturday night we have public appearance of the Nutcracker and Sunday afternoon. So if you want more information, call 455-5321 or go on the line at www.southjackson.org, and there it is right there on the screen. Anyway, today I'm going to show a clip from a 2012 video of Long School of Dance with Farrah Jean Ford and Elliot Amadian, wonderful couple. They're doing the pas de deux from The Nutcracker by Tchaikovsky.
Thank you.
Smoking tobacco accounts for 3 of every 10 fire deaths in the United States.
Tullahoma Fire Department, Tullahoma Fire Department, need you en route to a structure fire, 202 Main Street, heavy smoke showing. Neighbors advise child trapped inside.
Lighters, matches, and associated smoking paraphernalia are the leading cause of preschooler fire deaths. We as firefighters know that most structure fires can be prevented.
I've got one.
Command, this is primary search. We have a victim. Need EMS to meet us at the front door.
Please help us to give you a fighting chance. This can be prevented. Contact the Tullahoma Fire Department for a free home safety inspection.
What's a Tennessee vacation? It starts off like any road trip, and then, boom, adventure and thrills everywhere you look, which happens to be some of the most beautiful scenery in the country. Music here, history there, and all kinds of green in between. Come relax and unwind, or bring the crowd for some stargazing. Or stargazing. Whatever you do, come hungry and expect an awesome soundtrack. It's all right here in Tennessee. We're playing your song. For a free vacation guide, visit tnvacation.com.
Get your news first, fast, and free with your news leader on 6 every Tuesday, Thursday, and Saturday nights at 6, 8, and 10 p.m. Local weather, sports, community calendar events, and a comprehensive look at the latest news stories and newsmakers as only a video news broadcast can do. Get it first, fast, and free with News Leader on Channel 6, your local information network.
Welcome back. I get so many great opportunities to meet young people that have wonderful talent. This young man I met when he was 4 years old, Connor Rossdale. Hey, Connor. Good to see you.
Good to see you.
He made his first appearance on South Jackson Goes Country in 2002.
Yep.
Four years old. Been playing ever since? When did you actually start the guitar?
I started when I was 8.
When you were 8.
I'm 21 now, so do the math. Huh?
Here you are, an old man.
Yeah.
We're going to have Connor play one of his songs. Is this an original?
Yes, it is.
And what's the name of it?
This one's going to be called Another Place, Another Time. I wrote this with the guys that I play with in our band, Salem Creek.
Another Place, Another Time.
What you dancing with him? See the look in your eye. The song that's playing is a slow one. You're both moving in time. The lights are way down low. Girl, you shine like that. When I dance that way with you, in another place, another time, the skies were always blue, there was only me and you, when you were still mine. Another bottle on the table. Try to help me ease the pain. The thought of you and him together. try to drink you off my mind. But this heart just won't forget.
I have to thank Marty Scott for letting you out of work today. I hadn't thought about that.
That's my day job. I work over at Marty Scott's Hometown Auto Sales on East Carroll
Street.
Well,
you tell him I appreciate him letting you come in today. When did you write your first song?
Let's see. About 8 years old.
When you got your guitar, you started writing.
It's kind of a natural process there.
It's a fantastic talent, though. Not everybody does that.
True.
Just up and write.
Some people just play other people's songs, but...
You like to do your own.
Yeah, I do.
And I know that you play with Salem Creek.
Yep.
And you all have a band. And obviously, you played on the country show, and you've sung on that. I just have to tell you, on this year's South Jackson Goes Country, anytime anybody was absent and couldn't practice, there was Connor. He knew every word to every song. And he's the man that can run the sound and run the lights and do just about anything you need.
Right.
What do you hope to do with your music?
I just hope to play it for people and hopefully make enough to survive doing it. But I just want to play it for people.
Well, you have a great voice. If you got another song you might do?
Sure.
What would it be?
This one's called Wheels Roll On. Actually, the first year that our group, Salem Creek, did the country show, we did this song.
You did Wheels Roll On. I remember that.
Yep.
It was a good song.
It's a trucker song. My dad used to be a trucker, so he brought the idea to us, and we kind of put it together. It goes a little something like this.
Up before the sun on a Monday morning, kiss my wife and kids goodbye. Up ahead I can see the storm clouds forming. Headed west and I've got to make good time. Staring at the road through a dusty windshield. Million miles from my home. So many thoughts, and yet I still don't know how I feel. All I know is these wheels keep rolling on. And these wheels go on, chasing the sun down a lonely highway.
pretty cool.
I remember now when you all did that.
Yep.
And the harmony on the chorus, that's beautiful. And the three of you, it's three of you, right? Plus
yeah.
a drummer. Anyway, and he can sing too.
He can, yeah. So now it's four-part harmony.
It's really nice when you have everybody in the band can sing.
That's
it
right.
really makes it easier. What inspires you most to write a song, Connor? Can you
really
put your finger on it?
Depends on what the song's about. I really can't put a finger on it. It's the only way I know how to express what I'm feeling. I'm not really a good talker, so put it into music form, though.
And it makes you feel better.
Mm-hmm.
I think that is something to speak to for people that get depressed or they
oh,
do
yeah,
or whatever.
For sure.
If they would learn to do something constructive, like it could be writing music, it could be learning an instrument, and maybe it's
or
baseball, but whatever.
Painting, but anything like that.
It's so important.
To you.
It's so important in life to keep everybody going. Well, I brought you here to hear you sing as much as I possibly could. So do you feel like doing one more?
Yeah, sure.
And don't forget the name Connor Austell. One day it's going to be up in lights, I guarantee you, and he's going to send me $1,000 just for being a nice friend.
I'm going to do one that my Uncle Jeffrey wrote. It's called Alabama. Baby, been a long time since I've seen old Alabama. Wonder how my family's doing down. If the dogwoods are still blooming in the spring, wonder if the Sunday morning church bells still ring. But I've been on the road now about a year, but it feels like 10. Wonder if I'm ever gonna make my way back home again. And oh, oh Alabama, I really want Ford down those country roads again. Wanna find a southern belle that knocks me to my knees. Wanna sip the cider while the sun goes down and feel that Alabama breeze. But I've been on the road now about a year, but it feels like 10. I wonder if I'm ever gonna make my way back home again. Yeah, well, I really wanna see you, my friend. Oh, oh, Alabama. I guess I'll just dream until then. Yeah, oh, oh, Alabama. I really wanna see you, my friend.
Job. I guess we have to wrap it up here. I want you to know I love you and I appreciate you taking the time to come here today.
Let me just say something real quick. You can find my band's music on iTunes, Spotify, anything like that. And we also have a Facebook page. So if you're interested in what you heard just now,
look up Salem Creek
on Facebook, like I said,
right.
You can get all the info there.
We'll be back.
Here at Manchester Funeral Home, we know the importance of living and working in our local community because it's those families who we serve during their time of need honorably. We believe in supporting local business and offer only 100% Batesville caskets, the best in the industry and a driver of our local economy. If you want straightforward and fair pricing while working with the people you know, choose Manchester Funeral Home, serving your community since 1932. And pre-planning and pre-funding can be the best gift you ever leave your loved ones. Call us to pre-arrange. Manchester Funeral Home. Our family, caring for your family since 1932.
If you want to be a parent, It doesn't matter how you play, what you wear, how you dance, or even what direction life takes you. You just need to be there. You don't have to be perfect to be a perfect parent. Thousands of teens in foster care don't need perfection. They just need you.
How long has it been since you raced a cheetah? Are your tornado creating skills getting rusty? Tired of being the only one in your neighborhood who hasn't built a dinosaur? Sounds like it's time to visit the Hands-On Science Center. The Hands-On Science Center is an indoor science playground. In this museum, please touch is the rule. Join us for weekly science demonstrations on space, lasers, lizards, rocks, and a whole lot more. No two visits are ever the same, so visit often to see our ever-changing exhibits and demonstrations. The Hands-On Science Center, 101 Mitchell Boulevard in Tullahoma.
Tell you what, I'm glad Connor came on, and
I want
you folks to remember he didn't have quite enough time for decadent self-promotion, so go to their website and go to their Facebook page.
Look up Salem Creek
and buy something, order something from them. They're great, they're good people, and have worked real hard in this community and helped made a lot of good things happen around here.
Oh my goodness, she has a wonderful family. They're all talented. It's amazing. You know, I love it when I see
and
my whole
family. And I love his barefoot mama.
I do, too. Oh, and don't forget.
I don't know whether she's wearing shoes yet. Is it cold enough for her to wear shoes?
She preaches barefoot.
Preaches barefoot. She's a minister.
She went and got her
credentials to be a minister.
Yeah, I was trying to think, what did you call it?
Ordination.
I guess so. Yeah, I know she was ordained.
She's ordained.
I want to remind you not to forget the Nutcracker. If you are homeschool or you want to bring children anytime, well, there's two productions at least on Friday, a week from this Friday, and then the weekend we have the show going on at South Jackson Civic Center.
That's right. And one more little bit of decadent self-promotion. Don't forget to go buy couches and pick up my second edition book of Loku. And it's $20. Great stocking stuffer. Great Christmas present for anybody. Look inside this deluded, crazy little mind of mine 200 times. There's 200 pieces in there. So
and you're busy
$20,
on book three, right?
That's a one penny a piece.
There you go. That's a good deal. You can't beat the deal.
One penny a piece. So, hey, we appreciate you. We're going to close today with some vintage Thanksgiving video, and we hope you enjoy it, and be safe out there. Christmas time's right around the bend. Christmas parade is a week from Friday night, so be safe, shop local, spend your money with local business when you can. Isn't that right?
Bye.
That's right. Bye. Bye.
Dad. I've been trying to read, but I just can't seem to do it. I keep thinking about today, Thanksgiving Day. We Johnsons had a good Thanksgiving, the best we've ever had. And I can't help thinking that what made it better was a feeling, a real feeling of thankfulness. And that's odd, too, when you consider the shape things were in when I got home from work yesterday. Kids, Dick and Tommy and Susan, were all home from school. And of course, Mother and the baby were there. As kids will, mine were living tomorrow right along with today, looking forward to Thanksgiving. And like most men, I'm glad it was Mother instead of me who had to break the news to them.
Tomorrow's Thanksgiving.
Turkey and dressing and pie and cake.
And fruit salad and whipped cream and cranberries. Gee, I can hardly wait.
Me too.
Well, you know, children, we've had a lot of expenses this month, and, well, your father and I thought that... Well, the truth of the matter is, there just won't be any turkey this year.
No turkey for Thanksgiving?
Oh, I'm going to make a pumpkin pie, and we'll have plenty to eat, but, well, we'll just have to get along without turkey.
Mom, you don't mean it. It won't be Thanksgiving at all.
Even the pilgrims had a feast. After all, isn't that what Thanksgiving's for? I don't think it's fair.
And it was right there that I came in, right in the thick of it. Hello, everybody.
Hi, Pa.
Oh, Mother, Dick, Susan. Well, what's been going on around here? What's the matter with everybody, anyway?
Mom says we're not going to have any Thanksgiving. No turkey, no good thing.
A fat lot we're going to have to be thankful for.
I don't think you kids really mean that.
We do, too. We've always had turkey for Thanksgiving.
Yes, and everybody else in the block's going to have it this year. Same as always.
Yes, we've always had turkey, just as a lot of Americans have had it, and we'll keep on having it. Turkey on Thanksgiving's a great American tradition. But what you kids are saying makes it sound as if the turkey's the only thing we had to be thankful for.
Well, gee whiz, no, Dad. It's not that at all.
Oh, I know, Dick. With turkey, it's easy to lose sight of what Thanksgiving really means.
And don't think we're just making excuses because we don't have any turkey this year. We know it'll mean a lot more to us the next time we do have it.
Well, sure. Suppose we don't have a bang-up feast. We're still a lot better off than the pilgrims.
That's it, Dick. And do you other kids see what Dick's trying to say? Turkey or no turkey, we've still got all the freedoms and privileges the pilgrims gave us. And out of those privileges have come a lot of things. Things the pilgrims never even dreamed of.
Why, we could make a list a mile long.
Why don't we do it?
Now, hold on a minute. You've got the idea, but it isn't something you can write down like a grocery list. You've got to feel it down deep before you can really be thankful for anything. I tell you what let's do. And let's take a little more time to think this over. When you get right down to it, there are some pretty tough decisions in making up your mind what means the most to you. Your life? Sure, that's one thing you can't get along without. But do you know that there are some places in the world today where you have to get along without just about everything else?
Golly, Daddy.
I guess I kind of got carried away. But I'll bet you one thing. If we really think over what we have to be thankful for, when we sit down to whatever Mother fixes to eat tomorrow, we'll be one family in America that will really have a Thanksgiving dinner. Well, that's how it got started. The Johnsons didn't have any turkey. And the kids, no, I mean everybody, likes to make something special out of a special day. So we fell back on something as old as the Pilgrims, toting up the common, ordinary blessings that we had to be thankful for. That night, I'd see Dick there building his model airplane and Susan just playing. Only they weren't just playing. They were mulling things over, thinking big thoughts for such young heads. And as for Mother and Tom and baby Janet, and yes, me too, it was as if we had our eyes open for the first time, things there were to appreciate in just any ordinary day in America. When we took our places around the table and we were ready. And then, well, we all knew it. There are some things you just can't say. But everybody in his own way knew what he had to be thankful for, and that this was the time to think about it. Tom was first.
I am thankful for getting plenty to eat all the time, with extras that count, like cookies and milk after school. Like Mom says, I'm hungry all the time anyway, and if I didn't live in a country where there was plenty to go around, golly! And I'm thankful for the free public library, where I can get books about adventure. Jack London, Richard Halliburton. Gee, the way they tell a story is as good as being there yourself. And it's free, with only a library card.
Yes, Tommy thought about some of the things he ought to be glad for all the time. And somehow, turkey and trimming seemed to matter a whole lot less than he thought they did yesterday. Well, then it was Susan's turn. Susan's a happy-go-lucky kid. You'd never credit her with thinking beyond her dolls, but she got right into the spirit of it.
I am thankful we have what we need to wear, though Mother says it's hard to keep up with us, we grow so fast. I never thought before how many clothes it takes for all kinds of weather, or how it would be to have to do without the right ones. I'm glad to be able to go to Sunday school, or go to any church I want, any Sunday. I'm thankful for my mother and daddy, that they are here with us, that both of them aren't too worried about things to take time to have fun with us. I'm glad we're a family, that families are still important in America.
I guess Dick, being the oldest, was having some pretty serious thoughts.
I am thankful for being able to get an education, for living where schools, all schools, open their doors to a guy who wants to learn, where school books are studied instead of burned, where a guy is rated by how much he knows, and the community is rated by how well it teaches him. I'm glad I've got a chance to play, batting a ball around once in a while. Stuff like that. I'm glad it's fun, growing up in America.
Sure, baby Janet's too young to understand the big word, Thanksgiving. She's too little even to tell us the things that make her happy. But we can tell, and maybe she's thinking about them now. Maybe she's thinking about the fun of splashing around in the tub and about how good it feels to be clean. About playtime with mother and the security she feels in mother's arms. And as for mother, seems she's always working, cooking, ironing, tending children, daylight to dark. What does she have to be thankful for?
I am thankful that my children had the privilege of being born safely and of growing up healthy and strong. I'm thankful that I have the privilege of guiding them as they become useful men and women. And I'm thankful for all the things our American system makes possible for the Smiths and the Browns and the Johnsons, for washing machines, hot water out of a tap, and a telephone to call the doctor when one of the family is sick. A car to get Dad to work. Yes, I'm thankful for all the things free people working together can produce. I'm thankful that when my neighbor drops in to borrow a cup of flour, we've got the right to talk about anything we want to. The parent-teacher project, the new mayor, or Jane Jones' hat. And last of all, I'm truly thankful for the peace of mind that Dad's job brings, for knowing that even though there are lots of luxuries we can't afford, there still will always be enough to go around for the things we have to have. I'm glad Dad doesn't work slave hours, that there are evenings and Sundays and vacations when we can all be together.
That's Mother for you. Grateful for what America means to her family. And now for me. I've got so many things to be thankful for. I'm thankful for this house. It may need a coat of paint, it has a mortgage, but it's ours, a place where we can be together in privacy. And I'm thankful for the thing that makes this house our home, the happiness here. Not just today or on Christmas morning, but on a day-to-day basis all through the year. For knowing that a knock on our door means nothing to fear. A friend calling, or maybe a bill collector, or a kid selling magazines. You never know what to expect. But you can count on one thing. It's not going to be some political gangster coming to drag one of us off to jail because we believe in freedom. And I'm glad that that freedom we've got lets me choose the kind of work I like and can do best. Taking a sluggish motor and making it hum again. Makes me feel that somebody got to his work, or wherever he had to go, just because of me. And feeling like that gives me a lot of satisfaction. And I'm thankful for my newspaper. Just a few cents worth of printer's ink and paper, but more valuable than any amount of money. Because in it, the editor's got the privilege of printing what he thinks, and I've got the privilege of agreeing with him or not, however the facts strike me. And both of us, the editor and I, have the right to act on our opinions on election day, to vote for the principles we believe in. And finally, I'm thankful for being able to believe, in spite of everything, that somehow, someway, the unity we've got here in the Johnson family will someday spread to men and nations throughout the world. For all these things, we are truly and humbly thankful. Amen.